My talk is a bit teaching to the choir here, because I'm going to show you something where conventional programming sucks and makes a problem infamously hard, and functional programming, in particular pure functional programming in Haskell, makes it trivially easy. But I think you'll still like the story. And maybe that's something to take away for your own work, or even you have to convince other people why functional programming is great. But first, let me give you some context. The project that I'm describing here happens in the context of CodeWorld. Has anybody here heard of CodeWorld before? Can I see some hands? OK, a few hands, that's good. CodeWorld is a web-based programming environment created by Chris Smith to teach, first and foremost, math, but also programming, to middle school students. And despite this target audience, he uses real, proper, normal Haskell with some additions to make it a bit more pretty. And it works so well because he provides the students with a very simple and abstract interface to whatever they are trying to do. So the first thing that the students are doing is they are drawing static pictures by writing code that describes the picture in a functional, composable way. You can think of the gloss library, if you know that. It's been around for a while. So in that style. And then they get a function called drawing off in this case that takes one of these pictures that they describe with their code and turns it into a program. And that's all they need to write a simple program like this. I won't go into detail, but you can see there are some composition of geometric primitives and transformations. And if they run this in this environment, they see a smiley. So this web-based interface is basically an editor window. They have a button to press run. The code gets compiled on the server to JavaScript, sent to the client, and then it runs in the browser of the user, which is nice because they only have to work with the browser. And that's good to teach them some basics about programming, but after a while, the students get, After a while, the students get bored, because just creating a static picture that doesn't move is not very satisfying. And that's when they go to the next stage and they implement interactive things. So in order to create an interactive program, they have a slightly more complicated function to use, but it's still very simple. So this function takes three arguments. The first one is an initial state that describes what they're doing. And they are free to choose whatever type they want to describe the state. It could be a single double if it's just a time, like a watch. Could be some complex data structure. Then they describe in the second argument how the state of this program changes given some user input. An event is just a data type that's a button press or a key press or a mouse movement, and that's it. And then finally, they describe how to draw the state to the screen. And with this simple model, they can create complex interactive games, like this complex interactive game, where I can click and then the state changes, and I can click again and change again. And you can see how you can probably see how I can implement this game using this very simple interface. In fact, so for more interesting games, you want things to move, even if you're not clicking and pressing buttons. So actually, the interface is a bit more complicated. There's yet another function. It's the second one now, which takes a double, describing the amount of seconds, usually fractions of a second, that have passed since the last time we've updated the state. And this gets called repeatedly, basically with every refresh of the of the display. And now students can implement things where games where things are moving. So this is a game that you recognize. You don't see it, but I'm pressing W and I'm pressing S to move this one, and I'm pressing up and down to move this one, and I can play Pong here. And in fact, this is not a video. This whole presentation that you see right now is programmed inside CodeWorld using precisely this interface. So everything you see was me filling in parameters of this function in some 2,000 lines of code. But at the end, you'll see a link to the code, and you can look at it if you want. But this this is also the excuse why I'm confined to this part of the screen, because the canvas of CodeWorld happens to be a square. So you don't expect anything to appear to the left and right of that. Great. So the students can create interactive two-player games, and they can play it if their friend sits next to them and presses the other two buttons on the key. But you know kids these days. They sit at home on their computer, and all their friends sit on their computers. So maybe we want to connect them so that they can play their game together over the internet. And then our students will be happy again. So how do we change the interface to enable that? And we've seen talks that talked about events and functional reactive programming. And probably with this audience, you start thinking in terms of code. OK, maybe we need to send messages. So maybe we give them a string to network function, and they can serialize their data. Or maybe they get to choose their message format, and then they receive messages and react to them. But that's all much too complicated. That's not what we can do with sixth graders. Instead, we need to try harder to find something more abstract. And what I'm looking for is something as simple as this. If you squint, this looks almost like the previous thing. There are a few minor additions. And the idea is that the abstract model of a multiplayer game is still a single state that reacts on what this player over there is pressing and reacts to what this player over there is pressing. And it ignores the fact that there are messages that have been passed over the network and all these things. So basically, we want to say that when we get an event from the environment, we want to know which player pressed it. And that's the main change. We also maybe want to show a different view to different people. Think of a first-person shooter or a card game. Different players see different things. So the draw function also receives the player number. And then we want to specify how many players the game takes. This is a two-player game that we've seen, but there might be more than that. So the challenge is to give the students this interface, let them do whatever they want with it, and implement this in a way that you get multiplayer interaction over the network. And that's challenging. So to think about a few options that we might come think of. So if we were just to program a multiplayer version of Pong directly, then we would probably think about, OK, if we press a cell, we send the coordinates of the cell over to the other player. When the other player receives it, he can update the screen. When this player presses a button, we send the coordinate back. And now the first player knows what's happened. That's fine if you want to program Pong. But in our case, we want to program something that works for any game that the user writes. And we have no insight into what's happening inside the game. We have no insight in what are the the abstract idea of a move. And we can't even transfer the game state as a whole, because our function was polymorphic, and it could be anything, could contain functions that we can't serialize and send over the network. So this doesn't work. Another approach might be to say, OK, let's say this player is the master player. He does all the computation and sends to the other player just the output of the screen. So when the first player selects a cell, we send over the new content of the screen. When a second player presses something, we have to send back this message, I press 2, and then it gets an updated screen from the first player, which would work. But it's very bad user experience, because when this player selects something, there'll be a delay until things are happening, which might be OK for Pong. It might be OK for tic-tac-toe, but certainly not going to be much fun for Pong. So from this, we deduce that all the players, all the computers in the network, need to maintain a state on their own, because they need to react upon local key events immediately. Otherwise, it'll just not be fun to play these games. And that basically leads us with the final option. Both players maintain their state locally. They send over events as they happen. You receive the event over the network, and then you just react to it. So let's look how that works. So here we have tic-tac-toe. But this is actually two copies of the game running at the same time, simulating the two players. So I can play the first player here, and I can play the second player here. And right now, there's no delay. The network is instantaneous. So things look like very boring and just like before. So let me introduce a network delay of 5 milliseconds. 0.5, half a second. And now you see if I select the cross over there. It takes a little while until the other player notices it. But we can still play this game, and it kind of works. So OK, problem solved. We can do this now. Now let's see what happens when we play Pong. So again, this is two versions of Pong. We can see it's overlaid. And as long as the network is instantaneous, things are working just fine. So let me introduce a small delay of 100 milliseconds. And as I'm playing the game now, things kind of look OK. You hardly notice that there's a small delay between the mouse, the movements. The interesting thing is, what happens if, let me try to get that, the ball goes through the wall while the one player thinks the pedal is there and the other player thinks it doesn't. Suddenly, we have now two games running, completely independent. We can overlay it again so you can see the ball is not in the same position anymore. For a while, the students will be, actually, the players will be more happy now because now the blue player is going to scoring all the time and the green player is scoring all the time, and they are wondering why the other player is making these completely senseless moves because they see a completely different version of the game. So this is fun but not good. And the solution has been around for decades. John Carmack, the guy that created Doom and Quake, did a lot of research in this direction and implemented a lot of things. And it's called lockstep simulation with client prediction. And the idea is it's a minor addition to what we've seen before. Instead of just transmitting only, I'm pressing this button, you also tell the precise time, and time means game time internal to the game, that this button has been pressed. And so you transmit keystrokes with time, and you get back keystrokes with time. And what you can do then is, so as I'm receiving a message from the other player that he pressed a button maybe half a second ago, I can go back in time, rewind my state of the whole system by half a second, apply the change that this has occurred, that this causes, and then fast forward to the current time, maybe again applying any local events that have happened since then. And I can, in retrospect, integrate the information that I got from the other side into the state. And we can do that. And then we have a version of Pong that does not have the problem. So let me create a large delay so that it's more visible. And you can see as I move the pedal that for the other player on the lower edit, with this long delay, it's a bit jerky. So the pedal starts late, it stops late. It doesn't really look great. But even if you have a problem like before where one player thought I'm missing the ball and the other one doesn't, which is actually kind of tricky to produce. So I have to look at the right player. Yeah, I think right now it has happened. For a brief moment, the things were out of sync. But as soon as the event reaches the other player that I've moved the pedal into the ball's path, it'll resynchronize and things are going same again. And although we've had these problems, you can see that the games are still perfectly aligned. So in a way, I'm done now. This approach of doing this thing works fine. And our students are happy. They can play multiplayer games now. So why am I standing here and telling you the story? Well, in functional programming, or at least in pure functional programming, there isn't much to tell. It just works. So let me tell you what other people think about this problem. This is a quote from a professional game developer from 7 years ago, somewhere on the web forum, where he describes that one of the most vile bugs is a desync bug. And I'll skip the next line because I read the code of conduct. And the assumption is that all players are synchronous. But if that, for some reason, is no longer the case, then we have chaos, anger, and suffering. And let me try to show you what can go wrong and how easy it is for things to go wrong. So here again, we have our Pong. We have two players. The difference in this game is now that the programmer was sloppy. And he implemented the counter for the score, and I hope this is not too small for everyone, in a global variable that he updates as soon as the ball passes past the pedal. And in this framework, what will happen once one player scores is, well, suddenly we have 3 points for this player. Because it happens that our framework, which has to rewind state and reapply it, was reenacting this ball passing the line three times. And then the global variable was updated three times, but never reverted because it's global. It's outside the scope of our system. And things get even much worse out of scope once we have some desync. So now they not only have wrong numbers, but they have different numbers. Now, and this simple thing is kind of like, OK, why did you do that? But imagine a game like StarCraft with lots and lots of moving things. How tempting it is to use some global variable here or some static variable inside a function. And it requires discipline from the programmer to do this. But I'm targeting middle schoolers who've learned programming 2 weeks ago. I cannot expect any discipline of them. So that's why in any other programming language or any other programming paradigm, this wouldn't be possible. And it's not just global mutable variables. So here's a different version of the game. And remember for a moment, maybe you've seen it a little bit, that the ball doesn't always bounce back at precisely the right angle. So there's some jiggling around. So if you run this game, and even if you don't do nothing, as soon as it hits the pedal, the balls are out of sync. This is because now the two instances of the game are using the random number generator in a non-synchronized way. So they both draw their random numbers independently. And obviously, this will cause the game to go completely astray and do weird things. And again, the problem is that in other programming languages, it's just too tempting to use rand because you need it at some point. Whereas in Haskell, a pure function cannot use some random number generator unless you give it one. But then you can make sure that you give all instances of the game the same seed to the random number generator. I guess I should have mentioned that I'm happy to take questions during my talk, because otherwise I'll have minutes at the end where I'm just going to be rambling not very exciting stuff. So feel free to interrupt me and make comments. So we've seen the problem. We've seen that we can solve it in functional programming. We've seen that it's tricky otherwise. So maybe let's have a quick look how to actually implement this. And this is not super tricky. In the simplest form, that's all the code that we need to conceptually describe what's happening here. And basically, you can think of that all the nodes in the network, all the players, they keep track of a log of all events that have happened. So which event has been pressed by which player, and then most importantly, at what time. And you keep track of this log. And every time you receive an event, either from your local user immediately or over the network, you just add it to this log. And we maintain the invariant that it's sorted. So you put in the event at the right position in this sequence. And then whenever you need to know the current state of the system, and for example, to draw it onto the screen, well, you just recompute the state from the very beginning. So starting from the initial state, you apply all the events. And because they're sorted, they're in the right order. And with this pseudocode, so to say, it's obvious that we achieve what we wanted to achieve. Assuming no messages get lost, and in our case, we're using WebSockets for communication, so it's based on TCP, so we have some guarantees that messages are being delivered in order. So eventually, every message will reach any other node, and they will all have the same string of events to look at. And because this is a pure function, they will all get the same state. This is not very efficient, so I could talk a little bit about, not efficient, also not complete, because there was this function that updates the state based on time, and you have to make sure that you apply this also in the same way in all clients. So independent of how often they refresh their screen, you want to make sure that you update the state based on time with the right same time quantas on all the machines to make sure that this works. And then there are some optimizations you can do. For example, obviously, as the game goes on, this log of events will grow and grow and grow. And it's useless, or it's kind of pointless, to always start from the very beginning to recompute it. Because once you've received an event from all other players, you know that nothing will ever change the history earlier than the oldest of these events from all players. So you can remember that state, forget all the events that were there previously, and then only recompute based on the events that have happened in the meantime until, like, basically from the time that you've last heard something from the most lagged player to the current time. You wouldn't want to use lists. There you want to use some other data structures. So there's a paper that I wrote about this together with Chris Smith, and it's not online yet, but it will be online in a short while, so keep tuned. It also discusses two minor problems where the promises of Haskell, of the purity of Haskell, don't quite hold. So the first one is, so we've seen the type signature of collaboration of. It was took some arguments and returned an I/O action. And nothing per se stops the programmer, if he's malicious, to, in his main program, first get some random numbers and then pass them in as part of the function that he passes to collaboration of. And to avoid that, you need to make sure that all nodes in the network run the same code with the same parameters. And it happens the case that there's a language extension to Haskell which was implemented for the purposes of cloud Haskell for distributed computing, which introduces the notion of static pointers. And they don't actually care what static pointers are for, but there's a syntactic restriction in this language extension that only things can be a static pointer that don't capture any free variables that are generally static. And that's precisely what we need. So we require the parameters of collaboration of to be static, and then we prevent the user from putting unwanted data in there. The other problem is related to floating point operations. And some of you might have wondered what floating point operations do here, because you always hear these horror stories about floating point operations not being very well behaving. It turns out that floating point number calculations are surprisingly deterministic. So we ran the same, like a multi-pendulum simulation, which would diverge very quickly when things are not precisely the same thing. And we ran it on different CPUs, different browsers, different operating systems. And we noticed that the normal addition, multiplication, square rooting, these kind of operations, they're fine. They are precisely specified by the IEEE standard, so they run the same on all the machines. You get into problems when you actually use functions like sinus, cosinus, and exponential functions, because they are underspecified. And depending on what CPU you're running on, or even what browser you're using, you get slightly different results. So if you're using these functions, then the promise of purity in Haskell doesn't quite hold. But it's possible to fix that simply by monkey patching the JavaScript environment to use an approximation to these functions that you write yourself that is only using polynomials, and then things are fine, which is good enough for this purpose. We're not doing scientific simulations here. Another interesting thing that I will just briefly touch upon, but it's kind of cool. So if you think about last time you played Counter-Strike, in case you have, when there's network lag, you will see that there are players that are where your computer thought they were here, but they're actually there. They don't jump to this position, but they rather smoothly move there. So this interpolation. And it's kind of would be nice to do interpolation. But we can't do interpolation directly here because we have no insight into the state. Again, the state is completely abstract to our generic system. And we cannot do interpolation in space, so to say. But there's a trick that we can do. Let's say I get the event from the other player that he starts to move. And it says it has happened half a second ago. What I can do to make things a bit more smooth is I can pretend that it happened right now. Then I have a continuous, sensible, consistent movement. And as my time goes forward, I put this event into my history further back smoothly until the time it was originally sent. And this means as my time goes forward, the player is with higher speed than usual, but it's still smoothly moving to the new position. This does produce its own artifacts, so it's not clear whether it's better than just jumping in all cases. But it is a very neat observation that even though we don't have insight into the state, by interpolating the arrival times of the events over time, we can provide a smooth user experience. So that's fun. I promised you to get you a break, so this is the last slide. It's unfortunate we don't have Wi-Fi, because otherwise I could now play Pong against one of you. But if you do have internet, you can play two-player Pong there. I guess I'll briefly show you how that looks in practice. So when you start these two-player games, you have this very generic main menu where you can either start a new game or join a game. When you start a new game, you get a code. And you share this with whoever you want to play with. If you join a game, you have to enter the code. And there's a share button that allows you to share the link of your current program to other players. That's a very simple interface that allows the students to write their code, get the URL to their current code version, send it to their friends on Snapchat, or probably bad choice for URLs, on Facebook Messenger, and they can go there and they can join your game and play. The takeaways of this talk was there's an interesting example. It's horribly difficult to get right in other programming languages. For us, it's so easy that we can have any middle schooler get it right because they can't get it wrong. This idea of keeping a log of things and integrating events might be useful in many other more serious applications. And of course, there's a whole theory about it, but it's good to see it in practice once. And if you want to teach people programming, look at CodeWorld. It's a very fun project. Thank you. And I'm happy to take a few questions.
With the event log approach, you can get sort of impossible histories, right? You both think you scored at the same time, because you have to resolve that.
Good point. So imagine a game where both players race for drawing a card and looking at it. In this current system, what's happened is both players press the button to look at the card at the same time. They will both see the card, and then by the time the events have crossed to their player and has been resolved, who was actually faster, then for this player, the display will change back and the card is hidden again. This is a problem for many games, and this system does not provide a protection against this. You could think about, you know, an interface to, I don't know, find out whether there's some uncommitted state, but this is complexity that you don't want to expose to the player. If you're trying to create a program like this in the system, add an animation which like unravels the card within like 300 milliseconds, and as long as the lag is low, smaller than 300 milliseconds, you're fine.
For a game.
For a game, it's okay, yeah. For, I don't know, a real world betting on real money, you might have to think about more complex solutions. Yeah. Okay.
Have you thought about putting a judge in the middle to handle? Have you considered putting a judge in the middle to handle situations like that, so that you basically have three players? One's the judge who will decide who sees that card.
Again, the problem is this is complexity that we want to hide from the user. So for the programmer, there's only one state and events are happening in the same state. And we want to preserve this model because it's really useful to get people to write their applications and their experiments. But in this model, there's no insight. We cannot write a generic judge that does it for everything because we don't know what events are colliding and which events are not colliding. If you're playing Pong, then they can both move the pedals completely independently and there's no need for arbitration there. And also any kind of decision that happens not on your own machine causes delay. So you want to move the pedal, you want to see it move immediately, and not just when the system on the server confirms that you actually move your pedal. So this is why we took this approach. There's one there and then there.
Regarding time, do you have like an authoritative source, like the server that gets the message, or do you use the clocks on each user's computer? And if you do the latter, is it bad for user experience? Have you found any problem regarding that? I don't know.
We're using, basically, the server sends out an event, game is starting. And as soon as you're receiving this event, you start your own time. So relative to the reception of this event, everybody has a synchronized time. It doesn't matter whether your clock is off absolutely terms. It would be desirable that all clocks run at roughly the same speed. But for a few minutes of games, we can assume that.
Okay, I think that's all the time for questions we have for now.
Okay, I guess.
We've got a few minute break, and then we'll be back.